So I call Daniel Owens to the podium of Liverpool John Morsh University.
My name is Daniel Owens. It's a pleasure to be here and present some of my PhD data on vitamin D and skeletal muscle remodeling. The reason that we're interested in vitamin D is because low serum 25OHD concentrations, the main marker of vitamin D status, are prevalent worldwide. Indeed, if we consider epidemiological data from across Europe, we see that almost half of the individuals tested present with serum concentrations less than 50 nanomole per liter, which will be considered insufficient or deficient. And this has got important health ramifications because vitamin D is a regulator of bone health, innate and acquired immunity, and recent data suggested skeletal muscle is also a direct target for vitamin D. Indeed, rats who are vitamin D deficient show an impaired recovery from a crush-style injury versus rats who are fed a vitamin D-rich diet, and this is evidence of both the cellular and whole tissue level. In humans, the data are less convincing and only correlative, but they do suggest that serum 25OHD is a good predictor of the recovery from eccentric exercise. Now, given the importance of recovery from different types of exercise and the high prevalence of low serum 25OHD, we wanted to investigate that link further. So the aims of my study were twofold. First of all, to investigate whether low serum concentrations of vitamin D, less than 75 nanomole per liter, affect the recovery from eccentric exercise. And secondly, to identify novel cellular mechanisms by which vitamin D may regulate skeletal muscle remodeling in vitro. So to realize the first aim, we utilized a randomized control trial. And what that consisted of was first screening a number of individuals for their serum 25OHD concentration. We then excluded those who presented with concentrations above 75 nanomole per liter, and then familiarized all of our participants with an isokinetic dynamometry protocol to elicit maximum voluntary contraction force. We then block randomized all of these individuals into two groups based on their MVC and 25OHD concentration. All individuals then undertook a bout of eccentric exercise consisting of 20 sets of 10 eccentric contractions, and we recorded MVC pre and post the exercise bout, then at 24 hours, 48 hours, and 7 days following that exercise bout. One group was then supplemented with vitamin D3 at 4,000 international units for 6 weeks, whilst the other was supplemented with a visually identical placebo. And then following that six-week period, we then remeasured 25OHD, and they underwent the exercise bout once again. So what did our results show? Well, first of all, our supplementation protocol was effective. We saw significant increases in serum 25OHD in the supplemental group, whereas the placebo group actually showed a significant decrease after that six-week period. Really interestingly, this led to a significantly improved recovery at 48 hours and 7 days following the damaging event, whereas the placebo group actually showed no change pre and post supplementation. And that correlated with a 10.7 and 12.4% improvement at the 48-hour and 7-day period. It's also important to note that this had no effect on muscle soreness, so both groups still experienced the same degree of muscle soreness pre and post supplementation. So at this point, we could say that vitamin D may indeed regulate some aspect of the recovery from eccentric exercise, but to realize our second aim, we wanted to identify some mechanisms by which this may occur. So we implemented an in vitro model. And what this consisted of was first screening another cohort of individuals for their serum 25OHD. And we ended up with a cohort of 14 who were all vitamin D deficient or had concentrations less than 50 nanomole per liter, one of whom is Sam Impey, who presented the other day. I still owe him a beer for this. We got a muscle biopsy from all of these guys, and then we mechanically and enzymatically dissociated the tissue to retrieve populations of muscle-derived cells that consist of skeletal myoblasts, which are muscle progenitor cells, and also skeletal fibroblasts as well. Now, with these populations of cells, we could then perform our investigative analysis, and this involved growing the cells to a confluent state in culture, then damaging them with a mechanical scrape with a pipette tip, and treating them with either a low dose, which was 10 nanomolar, a high dose, which was 100 nanomolar, vitamin D3, or a vehicle. And then we could monitor the migration process over 48 hours using live cell imaging. And what this allowed us to then do was look at certain migration characteristics, such as migration velocity, the distance traveled into that scrape, and also the directionality at which the cells move into the wound space. Now, that's a really important first step of myoblasts to reach the area that needs to be remodeled, but it's not the whole process. We also need to look at the ability of myoblasts to fuse to one another to complete the resolution of that remodeling process. And we did that by looking at myotube formation and morphology at 7 and 10 days following that initial injury. So what did our results show? Well, I'll first discuss the migration dynamics that we looked at. Really interestingly, both doses, low and high, resulted in significantly improved migration speeds compared with the vehicle control. And this led to a significantly greater accumulated distance into that site of injury, which you can also see from the microscopy images along the right panels of this slide. Another measure that we looked at was the directionality, which was how straight the cells migrate into that injured space. And there was no real difference other than a small but significant decrease in directionality with the high-dose treatment, which you can see from the individual cell tracks along the right side of the screen, with the 100 nanomolar dose showing a more random migration pattern. So at this point, we could say that the vitamin D enhances the migration characteristics of skeletal muscle-derived cells in vitro, but we still need to look at whether this results in improved fusion. So we did this first with a biochemical assay, looking at creatine kinase activity, which is a good marker of fusion of skeletal myoblasts. So first of all, the main finding that we found was that the low dose was actually preferential at all time points compared to both the high and the vehicle solutions, reaching significance at 10 days. Another really interesting finding from this was that the high dose seemed to actually be detrimental at 48 hours and 7 days, and only reaching the level of the vehicle by 10 days. We then also looked at myotube morphology, so how many myotubes were actually forming per field of view. And what we found, again, this mimicked the CK data quite nicely, in that the low dose was preferential over both high and vehicle. And actually, the high dose was detrimental at the 7-day time point, again, only reaching the level of the vehicle at 10 days. And you can also see this again from our red Desmond-stained images along the right panels of this slide. On top of that, we looked at the myotube area, or more appropriately, probably the circumference of these myotubes, at both 7 and 10 days. And again, the low dose was preferential over high and vehicle. And this was likely attributable to the fact that the low-dose cells were able to accrete more myonuclei, so more of the cells were fusing to one another to create longer and bigger myotubes. So to summarize what I've told you, first of all, we saw that individuals who have low serum concentrations of 25 OHD and are supplemented with 4,000 international units of vitamin D3 for 6 weeks show a significant improvement in maximum voluntary contraction force in the recovery period from an eccentric exercise bout. I then showed you some novel data that suggests that exogenous treatment of muscle-derived cells with a 10 nanomolar dose of vitamin D3 can improve the migration speed and distance, and also the fusion capability of skeletal myoblasts. But I'd just like to finish by putting this into some sort of context. I'm aware that pretty much everyone here understands the importance of remodeling and recovery from performance, from resistance type exercise, many types of exercise. But this is also important in elderly populations who show an impaired ability to recover from many types of exercise and day-to-day tasks. I started my talk by showing you some epidemiological data that show that vitamin D deficiency and insufficiency is prevalent worldwide. And our data, hopefully, have convinced you that low vitamin D status can actually negatively affect the recovery from an eccentric exercise bout. However, this can be easily corrected with supplemental vitamin D3. So by ensuring sufficient vitamin D, we can maybe therefore optimize the recovery process in skeletal muscle throughout all stages of the lifespan. That just leaves me to say thank you to everyone in this slide who I've already done, but I'd just like to say a special thanks to all of the guys from John Moores who came here and have gave a massive support to me throughout this week. So thank you very much, and thanks for your attention.